Professor Pokhriyal, but the faculty members and dear students, I always make it a point to visit at least one law school almost every month. I don't do it for the benefit of the students. I mainly do it to get some benefit myself. Because the interaction that I have with the students whenever I visit any law school is so rewarding, is so refreshing, that it puts me back, you see, to the time that was about 57 years ago when I graduated in law in 1962. I put myself, you see, in your place, at least speaking wise, if not actually, that stage is past now. We have seen the changes which have been happening in the legal profession. We have seen it happening, we mean my generation and also the generation prior to my generation. There was a time when in India they had a jury system which was introduced by the British as a part of their administration of justice. So I'm reminded of that. The last case was regarding jury system was the famous, one may call it famous, one may call it notorious, that was the Nanavati case decided in early 60s, you see, by the Bombay High Court and then went up to the Supreme Court. So the law teacher was addressing the law students, like all of you have assembled here, and he was giving some parting advice, because that was the last class, and after that the students would be leaving the law college and embarking on their own career progression in whatever field. So the parting advice he gave was that if you are strong on facts, hammer them to the jury. If you are strong on law points, hammer those points to the judge. So one brilliant lady student got up and she said, "Sir, if we are strong in none," he said, "hammer the table." So that was the time, you see, when we had the jury system, and of course that is now abolished. Now before we come to the main topic, because I will not be devoting more than 15 minutes on the main topic, as Professor Pokhriyal has mentioned, but it may be useful to give a brief background of the legal profession as it exists, you see, today, because it had its roots in the foreign domination which came to India with the British people coming. Started in early 1700s when East India Company came and set up and took control of the affairs of this country piecemeal. They eventually set up in different regions what they called the Supreme Court of that region. Now those courts were all manned by Britishers. Only British lawyers could appear. There was no system for the Indian lawyers to appear there. But gradually, the things changed and Indian lawyers were allowed to appear in the courts. That is what the British gave us, in the sense that the present legal education and the system of the administration of justice. The first batch of Indian lawyers were only there in late 1850s or 60s, you see. They were not allowed to practice initially in the so-called Supreme Courts of the different region, but gradually that was relaxed, that condition. What we owe to the British is that their system of legal education also brought in the concepts of liberty, equality, fraternity, which the British had also borrowed from Rousseau of France. Now with those, the Indian legal profession took roots in this country, and all of you are aware that lawyers had a very leading role in our struggle for independence. The father of the nation, belonging to this great state of Gujarat, he was a lawyer. The first president of India, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, he was a lawyer. The first prime minister of India, Jawaharlal Nehru, he was a lawyer. The first deputy prime minister and a great leader in his own right, Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel, he was a lawyer. These were the members of the legal profession who had taken a leading role in our struggle for freedom. And that leading role continues still today, even post-independence. If you look into who were the prime minister, who were the presidents of India, who were the leaders of the opposition, you will find many lawyers of great eminence who gave up their lucrative law practice. They joined politics, what we call politics, but not to subserve themselves, but to serve the country. That carried on. We had presidents like Dr. S.D. Sharma, prime minister like, of course, Jawaharlal Nehru, Narasimha Rao, and many others. In the cabinet that you have today, you have very distinguished lawyers. I'm talking about the central cabinet. You have Mr. Arun Jaitley, a very eminent lawyer, Ravi Shankar Prasad. In the opposition, you have Kapil Sibal, you see Mr. Chidambaram, and so many others. They're earning per day, if they practice law, would not be less than about rupees 40, 50 lakhs per day. So you imagine the sacrifice that these people have done to join politics. As I said, not for any selfish purpose, but to serve the country. Why I'm trying to tell you this is that the legal profession in India has what I have coined a phrase particularly for this, and I've been using it everywhere, PSR. You know about CSR, Corporate Social Responsibility? There is PSR, the Professional Social Responsibility. There is a big responsibility on the professionals, and particularly the legal professional, to give it back to the society. Society has nurtured them to be lawyers or law teachers or in-house counsel or those working in NGOs, but you have to give it back to the society. That is the role which the legal profession in India has to play, has to continue to play, for till the time, you see, the legal system remains the same. Now, as I said, when the British came to India, the doors were closed for the Indian lawyers initially. Then, of course, the entry was relaxed and they allowed the Indian lawyers to appear. Indian lawyers then came in the forefront in their own right. They stood for the rights of the people of this country. But what the British also brought was their own system of administration of justice. Now, it's a very difficult question, because we are all dealing still with the same system of justice. Whether that system of justice was suited for a country like India. Before the British came, there was all across the country what was called a consensual system of administration of justice. There was no emphasis on law. Law came, you see, when British came. The technical part, the codes, the acts. Earlier it was justice only. Because justice subserves everyone. Even law is an aid eventually to get justice. We had that consensual form at right from the village level, where we had the panchayats. They used to resolve the disputes. At the district level, we had what we called the Zila Parishad, the district parishad, the district councils, as we used to have. Now, slowly and gradually, these were replaced by a system which is three-four-tier system. That at the lowest level, initially we used to have a sub-judge. Above the sub-judge, we used to have a senior judge or a judge. Then you had a district judge. Then you have the High Court. In the High Court also, first you have a single judge. Then there is an appeal to the division bench. And important matters are referred, you see, to the full bench. Then you have the Supreme Court. And Supreme Court also, two judges benches, three judges benches, constitution benches, and then the full court and all that. Now this sort of a system for a populous country like India, that is my humble view, that it was not suited for a country like India. We are a very populous country and we are also very litigious people, or at least the British have made us litigious people. Therefore, what suited us was a very simple way. For the British, you know, it was very easy. That's a small country. England is a small country, you see. They could have the luxury of having a two-three tier, okay, you go to the county court, from county court, you see, you go to the state court, and then finally only the House of Lords or the Privy Council for the colonies. That was the system that was followed. They could well afford it. They had the luxury, you see, of having this. But in India, we did not have that luxury. This was imposed on us. Therefore, this system of administration of justice, again, requires a fresh look. And you people can be the vehicles of bringing about this change by having a national debate all over the country whether this system should be replaced by a more adaptable system, keeping in view the specific, special requirements of the citizens of this country who are still craving for getting justice, because justice does not come to them during their lifetimes. I can tell you with my 56 years of experience as a lawyer that it is not the generation which starts the litigation, which gets the result, it is the next generation. And then again we have, you see, the appeals and cross appeals and so many things are happening. So please consider this. I'm not saying you accept my view. There are always two views possible. But just debate in your mind, do some research as to what can be done. Now, as I told you, the British came. Now, in 1990s, there was a move for the opening of the legal services sector in India. The move came from the British law firms. There were four or five top law firms in UK which had their branches all over the world, including US, Japan, Singapore, that is Chapman Park and Asher Chris Morris, White and Case, all big names. They approached the Reserve Bank of India that they want to open liaison offices. Now you are all aware, liaison office means that a business entity is not actually engaging in business, they just want to promote their business which is being conducted from elsewhere. Like a companies based in US, they do not want to have an establishment or a factory or a unit set up in India, but they want to promote their product in India by engaging in a marketing exercise, in a sales drive and promotion. So those are the functions of the liaison offices to do that. The Reserve Bank of India, in total ignorance of what you see these people are seeking, they gave them the license to open liaison offices in early 1990s. What these law firms did was a total abuse and a misuse of the license given to them by establishing full-fledged offices, doing full law practice. Can you imagine a law firm having two full floors of Hotel Taj Mahal in Mumbai, two floors, to set up their offices? Similarly, in other places, they had taken virtually the properties and set up their offices. That is when the lawyers, by means of a public interest litigation, the name of the organization is Lawyers Collective, which was set up by now a very famous human activist lawyer, Indira Jaisingh. They took up the matter in Bombay High Court that this is an abuse of the license given to them and it is an illegal activity because the Indian Advocates Act does not provide for any non-citizens of this country to practice law, and these people are practicing law in India under the license given to them by the Reserve Bank of India. This was done way back in 1997. The Bombay High Court gave an interim direction pending the final disposal that they will not carry on their operation till the decision of the matter by the Bombay High Court. But the decision came after about 9-10 years, in 2009. The Bombay High Court decided that practice of law, now as you are all aware, there are mainly two streams of the law practice. Eventually even you people will have to think which stream you want to join after you complete your law studies. The two streams are the litigation side, where you appear in the courts. The other stream is the corporate law, transactional law, where you may be doing mainly desk work. Law, till the recent decision of the Supreme Court given about a week back. Then there was a parallel litigation in Madras High Court. That is known as the famous Balaji case, where again almost same issues were raised before the Madras High Court by the petitioner, a public interest activist. The Madras High Court, while broadly agreeing with what the Bombay High Court had said about the concept of the practice of law, what it includes and what it does not include, gave a small opening, a small window used to the foreign law firms that they can come to India on a fly-in, fly-out basis to advise their clients, either Indian clients who may be wanting to invest outside or who want to go for some international public issue outside India. So those lawyers can come to India for this advisory sort of work on fly-in, fly-out basis. Okay, you have come here for a meeting, for a discussion. You have that discussion and you go back. Then, if you are required again, you can come back again and pack up your bags and then go back to your... So this was the concept of fly-in, fly-out. But the Madras High Court also said that in arbitration cases, arbitration is now a globally accepted alternate dispute resolution mechanism. So we have multinational corporations disputes, we have international disputes, domestic disputes. Therefore, lawyers do visit. We visit, you see, foreign country. We visit Singapore, it's a big center of arbitration. We visit Paris, you see, the International Chamber of Commerce and all that. So we appear there. So keeping all this reciprocal arrangements which exist, these are unwritten reciprocal arrangements. The Madras High Court said that even in arbitration matters, with regard to the arbitration proceedings which are being held in India, the foreign lawyers can come and appear. So this was the difference between the Bombay High Court and the Madras High Court judgment. Now both these judgments were taken up to the Supreme Court of India. In Madras case, the Bar Council of India, which is the regulatory body of profession, it took up the matter to the Supreme Court, even challenging this small facility or privilege which was given to the foreign lawyers of fly-in, fly-out and arbitration. The foreign law firms came up against the Bombay High Court judgment saying that this judgment is wrong. Corporate and transactional work does not include practice of law. The Advocates Act only concerns, you see, the litigation matters. And they gave submission, you see, to the effect that the Bombay High Court judgment ought to be overruled. The Supreme Court of India, during a prolonged hearing lasting for about 2 weeks, and I had the privilege of appearing before the Supreme Court in this case on behalf of the Bar Association of India and the Society of Indian Law Firms. Our contention was that please consider the global scenario now. Let us forget, you see, as to what should be the law. Let us see the practical aspects of it. India is a signatory to WTO and GATS, that is the General Trade Services Agreement, and where, you see, it is committed to open the services sector globally. Contemporaneously, what is happening all over the world is that things are opening up. Thing is opening up, or in other words, we call globalization. So this globalization is there, opening up is there. Therefore, even the legal services sector ought to be opened up. The Society of Indian Law Firms, we had resisted this opening of the legal services sector to foreigners right from 1994 till the year 2013. And because we wanted this time to be given to the law firms of India to strengthen themselves, to make them meet the challenge of the foreign law firms when they come and set up their offices in India. To a large extent, we were successful. From the period of early 90s till now, we have the best of the law firms in India, nearly 200 top-class law firms which can compete successfully with the top law firms anywhere in the world. And I can say it because I am the president of that, so I know, you see, what is the caliber, competence and the potential of these law firms. Even in technology, they are not lagging behind. So we needed this time. Therefore, from 2013, we told the government that keeping in view the national interest and keeping in view whatever is happening outside India, globally, wherever now the services, legal services are being opened up, we support the government's initiative to allow the foreign law firms to come in a phased manner, as has been done by other jurisdictions, in a phased sequential manner. You please allow them, because we are now in a position to have a very healthy competition with them in the larger interest of the economic development of the country and the region and eventually the world. Our proposal was that, keeping in line what happened in Singapore, in Japan, in China, in most of these countries, that first you allow the foreign law firms to set a base to practice law of their jurisdiction. For instance, if a UK law firm wants to open an office here or a US law firm, then they should be allowed to do that. But they can practice only law of their jurisdiction. Supposing the Indian client wants to make an investment, you see, in UK, so they will consult the UK law firm which is based here with regard to the UK law, and similarly other jurisdictions. That is the traditional route which has been followed without any exception all over. The second phase could be to allow Indian lawyers to interact with them, to join with them. And third and final phase would be to permit them to set up their full-fledged law offices in this country without any restrictions. That was the proposal which had been given to us, given by us to the government. There have been meetings during the last 2 years with the Ministry of Commerce, which is the nodal ministry for WTO and GATS and all that, and also with the Ministry of Law and Justice, even with the Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad, and with the Commerce Minister Nirmala Sitharaman at that time, and even with the Prime Minister's office, where we told them that now we are ready, you can please allow them. But somehow things were not moving, we don't know, because of some adamant attitude on the part of the Bar Council of India. Because the Bar Council of India still seems to have some reservation as to whether they should be allowed, in what manner they should be allowed. Therefore, this issue, unfortunately, has not been touched by the Supreme Court in the recent judgment. The Supreme Court of India has confined its judgment to whether the Madras High Court judgment was correct or the Bombay High Court judgment was correct. They have not gone into the issue about the desirability or the propriety of allowing the foreign law firms to come to India. What has been done very cleverly by the Supreme Court is that they have said, these are issues which the government will decide, the Bar Council of India will decide, we will not offer any comments on this. Therefore, while upholding the Madras High Court judgment on allowing fly-in, fly-out, and also allowing arbitration, the Supreme Court has in a way further restricted by saying that even this should be regulated. Fly in, fly out should not be that every month the same partner of a law firm from abroad he is visiting at the drop of the hat. You see, he comes to Delhi, Bombay, Ahmedabad, anywhere. They say even this ought to be regulated, at what constitutes this fly in, fly out. So someone, that is the Bar Council, will have to regulate that there cannot be more than say 2 visits or 3 visits in a period of 3 months or 6 months or 1 year. We don't know what the rule will be. Even that has to be regulated, which was not the case which the Madras High Court decided. So the Supreme Court has further restricted this. And even with regard to arbitration, they say that arbitration definitely means the practice of law. Therefore, while we recognize the international significance of the ADR mechanism and why India should not be promoted as an arbitration hub, they say that even this should be regulated, there should be rules framed, there should be a code of conduct to be put in place by the government and by the Bar Council of India as to in what manner the Arbitration Council will come and appear before the Indian arbitral tribunals here. Now this was eventually, this is the judgment you see which has come, which has not touched upon the basic thing as to whether they should be allowed, in what form and manner, whether it should be a phased manner. Possibly the Supreme Court thought that they would be encroaching upon the government's and the legislature's domain by going into these questions. Therefore, they said these questions are best left to be decided by the legislature. And in a way, it is correct also for the reason that Supreme Court cannot amend the law. And what is required before the foreign lawyers are allowed to come to India is amendment of the Advocates Act. The Advocate Act, you see, clearly says citizens of India can only practice law in India. If that be the case, then foreign lawyers cannot establish their practice of law in India, whether they practice Indian law, whether they practice their own law, they cannot do it because everything amounts to practice of law. Therefore, an amendment of the Advocates Act in any case has to be made. But this is the issue which has been pending with the government for the last 2 years. No effective steps seem to have been taken despite several meetings that have taken place. I myself attended about 4 meetings, you see, with the law minister also, with the minister of state of law, with the commerce minister, the secretary law, secretary commerce, and even a special interministerial group was set up to go into this question, where, you know, all these proposals were given, but nothing seems to be moving. At that time, it was said that the matter is pending in the Supreme Court, therefore we will not take any action. Now the Supreme Court has decided, therefore let us see if the government will now take this forward or the Bar Council of India will see the reality that eventually this has to be done. The foreigners will come sooner or later, but let their the preparatory work should be put in place so that we in India, the Indian lawyers should know where we stand, the foreign lawyers who have been contemplating coming to India, preparing to come to India, they should also know where they stand. These are the steps to be taken. Now supposing they come to India, so what are the implications for the Indian legal profession and particularly for all of you who are here? It may take 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, by the time some of you would already be ready to jump into the law practice. Therefore, it is very important for you to prepare yourself for the challenges that will be posed by these foreign law firms when they come to India. The challenges will be that they may have a superior technology available to them. They may have some better research tools available to them. I don't think they have better law schools. The type of law school that I saw today, I think, is one of the most outstanding institutions which I have seen. And I have visited many law schools, not just in this country, but even in US and UK. I think in India, legal education is not lagging behind. Law schools are not lagging behind. But where we do lag behind is the use of technology and also research work to be done. We have the experience, we have the expertise to deal with most ticklish issues, even in the corporate law, the transactional side, the public issues, whether international or domestic. But in a way, where we suffer is that there possibly the law schools may have some role to play, that making you a complete lawyer. Whenever I address the law students, I always tell them that just going through your law books, the texts, the acts is not enough. In order to be a complete lawyer, you have to know much more than law. You have to go beyond law. You have to read literature, you have to read your cultural heritage, you have to look into the background, the history, you have to look into whatever is happening outside India contemporaneously around the globe. That is where I think we lag behind. There, it is one of the courses available to them about extra legal researches to be done by the law students there. A big responsibility is on the faculty also, you see, to make sure that these are made available. And where we do lag behind is this area, which is the gray area of not keeping yourself updated as to what is happening in the legal scenario in the United States, in UK, in Japan, in Singapore, and other places. My advice always to the law student has been that there is no best teacher which will make you know what is happening globally are the newspapers. Newspapers, you must read at least two newspapers every day. One, of course, the National Daily, whatever you want to read, but one financial or economic paper. That will keep you abreast of the whatever is happening anywhere in India also, and whatever is happening on the economic and financial side. Because eventually the function of the law is on the litigation side, you see, to provide justice to the people. But on the transactional and corporate side, it is to support the economic development of this country. You cannot have agreements signed between two countries, bilateral agreements, or between two corporations, two multinational companies, unless, you see, they have the legal support. That legal support has to come from you. And you will not be able to provide that legal support if you are not familiar with what is happening, what is the requirement, not just in India, but what is the requirement globally. Then I will look into it. It is his duty under the Advocates Act, under the Bar Council of India rules. Not that any rules are required. It is a basic requirement of this profession. That is why it is called a noble profession. So there are no, you have to, particularly these days, I can tell you in my office, my colleagues, they work till 12 or 2 in the night because of the time difference. If they have to talk to their counterparts in the US or in Japan, they are all very odd hours. So you have to keep on having that sort of a change, you see, almost every day. It's a very jealous profession. If you ignore it, you ignore it to your peril. It will not spare you then. Then you'll be nowhere. Be committed to the profession. Be dedicated to the profession. That is the message. And particularly, it's a very difficult thing for our lady lawyers, because they have to do multiple taskings, and that is also their duty, because they give birth to children who carry on with the generations. One cannot say that no, they should be only lawyers, they should not be mothers. They have to do both. They have to combine these various factors into their personality, that yes, we will be lawyers also, but at the same time we will be good wives also, we will be good daughters also, we will be good mothers. All that has to be combined. It's a very difficult thing. You, the ladies here will have a difficult task. Nothing, you see, so far as men are concerned. We have only one task, okay, go to the courts and attend the office and all that and earn some money. And if possible, give some to your wife also. If not, just pocket it, you see, and send it the way you want to do it. Therefore, I'm very happy to see that the ladies are playing a very big role in the development of the legal profession. In almost every law school, I find that at least 50% of the students are females. In the legal profession also, we find about 40-60 ratio, in some cases even 50-50% ratio. But unfortunately, that is where you see the ladder stops abruptly. We don't see many ladies coming up holding position of law officers, or being appointed advocate generals, or the additional solicitor generals, or the attorney generals, and still very few who are being appointed as high court judges, you see. And just one or two in every 5 years they come to Supreme Court. We must encourage and promote and ensure, and that can be done, you see, through a collective might. That we had the Women's Day only on 8th, I think, of March, when I was addressing the Delhi Law Faculty. They were celebrating the Women's Day, and many brilliant lawyers belonging to the females, they came and they addressed, and they highlighted that why equality is not being given to them in the field of practice of law. Yes, up to the level of student you are equal, but after that, you see, nothing seems to be happening. Even the courts do not take the lady lawyers seriously. If some young junior lady lawyers are arguing, they will say, okay, do you have any senior appearing with you or with you? Why don't you bring him? That sort of a mindset has to change, and that change has to be brought in by the law schools and also by our administrators, you see, that is the government, the parliament, and the Bar Council of India. You have a very, very important role to play, and you also have, as I said, the professional social responsibility of giving it back, you see, to the society. Excuse me. I mentioned to you about this PSR. The foreign lawyers, when they come to India, they will not have any PSR. For them, legal profession has become a business. But we in India, and we the Indians, have to ensure that law remains a profession. It is not turned into a business, you see. And if law and business have to go together, then business should encourage law, should promote law, as has been done, you see, by the promoters of this university. They are into big business. They are business magnates, you see, known now all over the world. But they have taken upon themselves to promote institutions of excellence, and one of the institutions being this Law Institute here, where we are standing today. I am standing here and you are sitting here. Therefore, there is a big responsibility on the future legal professionals to ensure that this remains a profession, it is not converted into a business. This challenge will also have to be met, because the issue is issues and challenges. This will be one of the challenges, because they have no commitment, you see, to do something for the people of India and all that, but we still have to continue to do that. And I'm very happy to see that there are legal aid activities going on here, the human rights activities are going on. That is the way we should continue to do it and inculcate these values which we have inherited, you see, from our forefathers, from our founders of the Constitution, from the father of the nation, and from the leaders who were lawyers. Thank you very much.